குட் மார்னிங் எவ்ரி ஒன். ஐம் டாக்டர் மோனோ ரபீஸ் ஆஃப்தல்ஜிஸ்ட் இன் பிரின்ஸ் கார்வர். டுடே ஐ வில் பி டேக்கிங் ப்ரீஃப்லி அபவுட் அனாட்டமி ஆஃப் த லென்ஸ். லென்ஸ் இஸ் அ டிரான்ஸ்பரண்ட் பைகான்வெக்ஸ் எலிப்டிக்கல் அண்ட் செமிசாலிட் ஸ்ட்ரக்சர் and it is a avascular body of crystalline appearance located between the iris and the vitreous. Basically, lens had a capsule of blood vessels which is supplied by hyoid artery before birth. I am talking about is hyoid artery, which is a branch of ophthalmic artery. These blood vessels will regress before the birth, rendering the lens into an avascular body. So the main nutrition post birth will be from the vitreous and aqueous humor. Nutrition is provided from these two elements. Coming to the location of lens. We all know in the vitreous there is an indentation or a fossa for the support of the lens. This is called as patellar fossa, where the lens resides in the vitreous phase. This is the vitreous phase. The attachment to the lens capsule and the vitreous phase is by a hyoidocapsular ligament. Hyoid means vitreous and capsule means capsule, also known as Wieger's ligament. The space inside this Wieger's ligament is known as Berger space or retrolental space. It's a potential space. In the sagittal section, you might see the hyoidocapsular or Wieger's ligament has like this. In the front view or in the coronal view, you will see as a circular attachment from the capsule to the vitreous phase, and the fossa in which the lens lies is called as patellar fossa. Coming to the dimension of the lens, equatorial diameter of the lens, that is from, first of all, what is equator? Lens has two surfaces, anterior surface and the posterior surface. The point at which this anterior surface and the posterior surface join is called as equator. In the sagittal section, it looks like this, and in the coronal section or in the front view, it looks like this. So this will be the equatorial diameter. At birth, it is around 6.5 mm and it goes on to become 9 to 10 mm in the adult, in the extreme ages. That is called as equatorial diameter. Then is one more diameter, that is the axial diameter or axial sagittal width. This corresponds to the thickness of the lens. It starts with 3 to 3.5 mm at birth, goes on to become 4, and towards the end, towards the extreme ages, that is around 8 years or above, it becomes 5 mm. And as I told you, lens has two surfaces. This is very important. One is the anterior surface and the posterior surface. The importance is which is more convex. Posterior surface is more convex. The radius of curvature of the anterior surface is 10 mm and that of the posterior surface is around 6 mm. If you see this, if this is the anterior and this is the posterior, it is something like this. Anterior surface, if I extend, it becomes a sphere of smallest, it becomes a bigger sphere of radius of curvature of around 10 mm. If you continue the posterior surface, it becomes a smaller sphere whose radius of curvature is around 6.5 mm or 6 mm. So basically what we are trying to say is the posterior surface is more curved. Posterior surface is more curved
than anterior surface. Why this has come as a question in the entrance exam, which surface is more curved? in the entrance exam you might not, you might forget this basic of this point. Now you might remember when you read lot of other subjects, you might forget this point. For that I have come up with the mnemonic. If you write P and A, the P has one curve, A doesn't have that curve. So remember, posterior has a curvature is more, radius of curvature is less. Radius of curvature is inversely proportional to the curvature. That you should remember. Okay. Same thing. And anteriorly, the radius of curvature is around 10 mm, but it is less convex. More convex is your more convex. Remember P. More convex is your posterior curvature, that is 6 mm. The thickness of the anterior posterior thickness is around 3.5 mm, which increases around 0.2 mm throughout the year. And equatorial diameter, that is the equatorial diameter, it is around 6.5 mm at birth and increases to 9 mm to 10 mm throughout the life. And the center of both the curves is called as poles. Center of both the curve is called as poles, namely anterior pole we have and posterior pole we have. The cornea, the distance from the back side of the cornea to the anterior pole is around 3 mm. It goes out to say that anterior chamber depth in the center is around 3 mm. Anterior chamber depth. The space between the back side of the cornea and the lens surface is nothing but your anterior chamber. It's around 3 mm. Now coming to refractive index of the lens, it's around 1.3 mm. Refractive index of the lens, for example, if you take the cortex itself, refractive index of the cortex, it's around 1.37. And of the nucleus, it's around 1.42 or 41. So roughly the total, the lens as a whole, the it is around 1.39. this should remember. And one more thing, cornea is 1.37 cornea. Now if you see, if we have a cornea and we have a lens, we know that as the refractive index increases, it should have more power. Lens is having 1.39 roughly, it's having 1.37 cornea is having. But still, cornea's power is more, that is around 48 diopter power of the cornea. But that of the lens is around 15 to 18 diopter. The reason being is cornea has to bend the ray of light from air whose refractive index is very less, around 1. But for the lens to bend the ray, it is from the anterior chamber, who is having aqueous humor, whose refractive index is around 1.3 something. So the difference of refractive index between the cornea and the air is more compared to the aqueous humor and the lens. That is the reason cornea is having more power than the lens itself. Coming to the lens capsule is nothing but a hyaline collagenous membrane, and it's transparent, which is surrounding the lens, and it completely surrounds the lens. Basically, lens capsule is originated or secreted by cells, anterior epithelial cells or epithelial cells itself, especially anterior epithelial cells of the lens. It is nothing but the basement membrane of the lens. Any epithelial cell will have a basement membrane. The basement membrane of the epithelial cells of the lens is nothing but your lens capsule. The few important point about this is it is one of the thickest basement membrane in the body, and among inside, if you look a capsule as a whole, thick, the front part of the capsule is more thicker. This is important. Front part of the capsule is more thicker than the posterior part. We'll try to find out the reason why is that. Periphery is more thicker than the poles, and capsular thickness increases with the age. If you see the lens, only in the anterior we have epithelium. Posteriorly we don't have epithelium in the mature, post-birth lens. The reason is, to start with, the lens had epithelium in the anterior as well as posterior. The posterior lens get used up for the initial fiber formation. This posterior lens, posterior epithelium is used, and it loses its epithelium. So basically, it will be something like this. Anterior epithelium is intact, the posterior epithelium is used. Subsequently, the subsequent fibers, this fiber constitutes to the embryonic nucleus. Subsequently, the pre-equatorial fiber, I will show the clear picture in coming slide. The subsequent fiber formation is by the equatorial and the pre-equatorial epithelial cells, which will equatorial and pre-equatorial, these epithelial cells will elongate, it will go anteriorly and posteriorly. Anteriorly and posteriorly, subsequent fiber formation occurs. Initially, it was posterior epithelium is used for fiber formation. After that, what happens is the elongation from the pre-equatorial fibers occurs throughout the 60 degree, throughout the entire spherical lens. This elongation occurs and will point, meet at a point. This is called the secondary fibers. Subsequent form fibers cannot reach a single point. This is subsequent fiber formation, cannot reach a single point. They will reach in a shape called as Y-shaped. Anteriorly, they will reach in an erect Y, and posteriorly they will reach in an inverted Y fashion. For example, this is the lens fiber from here to here, from here to here, from here to here. Understood? From here to here, from here to here. And this is fine. So we have a Y-shaped sutures in the lens. You can appreciate in the slit lamp sometimes. Sometimes this can go for opacification, causing sutural cataract, which is visually not important. Patient will not lose his vision because it won't block the vision. Sutural cataract. Subsequently, after Y, is a very phenomenal thing. Subsequent fiber formation will not even form Y, it will form irregular dendritic pattern of sutures, where anteriorly and posteriorly where the lens fibers meet. So this is what I was talking. This is anteriorly more thick, posteriorly thin. Okay, the reason why it is posteriorly thin is, see, anteriorly, as you all know, only anterior epitheliums are there. Those active epithelium is secreting the basement membrane. But for posterior, the elongated fiber which carries the basement membrane or which secretes the basement has to form the capsule. So that is the reason. Posterior capsule will be thin, anterior capsule will be thick. The clinical point regarding this is, any toxins in the anterior chamber on the vitreous tends to enter from the posterior capsule more than the anterior capsule. The reason it is being thin. That is the reason all this toxin-induced cataract or drug-induced cataract basically will be a posterior subcapsular cataract. Understood? In light microscopy, the capsule might appear transparent, homogeneous, but in ultra microscopy or in polarized light, it's birefringent or lamellar structure. This is what you should remember, lamellar structure. Basically, it is not one single thing, it has got many lamellae. Capsule itself has got around 40 lamellae is present. The importance of this is the superficial in glass blower's cataract. You should remember glass blower's cataract. There is a condition called as true exfoliation occurs. True exfoliation, not pseudo exfoliation, true exfoliation, wherein the superficial fibers, superficial lamellae will disrupt and form a exfoliate. It will exfoliate. So you have to differentiate true exfoliation from pseudo exfoliation. Pseudo exfoliation is a very common condition, is pseudo exfoliation in some particular belt associated with cataract, which goes on to become very, it is a amyloid, pseudo exfoliation is nothing but amyloid like structures, amyloid like substances getting deposited on the lens, in the iris, in the zonules, causing the zonules to be weakened. So it will be very challenging for the cataract surgeon to operate in such a condition, because if the zonules are weak, capsules are weak, it's very difficult for him to do the surgery. So there is something called as true exfoliation, wherein capsule itself is disrupting and seen in such a condition called as glass blower's cataract. But in pseudo exfoliation, it is not so. It is the amyloid-like structures, amyloid-like material which is present in the, which get deposited in certain conditions. So one more importance of this age-related disappearance of the lamellae. There is a disappearance of the lamellae which causes the to lose the capsular elasticity, which goes on to lead to the age-related loss of accommodation. For example, in presbyopia, one of the causes, the elasticity of the capsule is lost due to the disappearance of this lamellae. So here in this slide, what you have to remember is, basically, capsule is made up of type 4 collagen. Type 4 collagen. You know, as I told you, capsule is nothing but basement membrane. Basement membrane. And almost all basement membrane is made for type 4 collagen. To remember, basement membrane can be thought like a floor. And it has a collagen of type 4. So this should be the mnemonic to remember. Other than that, there is a type 1, type 3, laminin, fibronectin, heparin sulfate, all these things. Coming to the lens epithelium, it is a single sheet of cuboidal cells present deep to the capsule but in front of the lens proper. It is cuboidal in sagittal section. If you do the sagittal section, it is cuboidal. But if you see from top, it is polygonal in shape. Around 5 lakh cells are there in mature cells. So you see, the centrally it is around 5,009 mm square, but as you go periphery, the density increases. The reason being, you know, the active region of the cells is periphery, equatorial and pre-equatorial region, where there is active mitosis occurring, which helps in the fiber formation. That is the reason density is more at the periphery towards the equator, and there is no posterior epithelium. You know why there is no posterior epithelium? That is because it is used for the primary lens fibers. In, for example, this embryonic nucleus at the gestational age of 1 to 3 months, at that 1 to 3 months, these fibers are used. Coming to the structure, you have an anterior capsule, anterior epithelium, cortex. The nucleus can be divided into, based on the age of fiber formation, embryonic, It's around 1 to 3 months of gestational age. From 3 months till birth, it is fetal. It is called as fetal. Then infantile is from birth to puberty. Remember, birth to puberty, whatever the lens fibers formation is called as infantile. And post puberty will be your adult nucleus. Cortex is nothing but young lens fibers. Very young lens fibers will be the cortex. Surgically, it is not so important. Surgically, what is important is you have a capsule, then you have a nucleus, then you have a cortex. You have a nucleus, you have a cortex, and in between the cortex and this thing, you have epinucleus. So basically, capsule, then you have cortex. In between cortex and the nucleus, you have epinucleus. And nucleus, and you have a nucleus. Capsule, the surgical importance of capsule is, to form capsular axis to remove the, in surgery, to remove the nucleus, anterior capsule will be taken off. Cortex in cortical wash. Epinucleus, sometimes very important in surgery, especially if you expect a PC rent, so they preserve the epinucleus before removing the nucleus, they preserve the epinucleus so that nucleus is not dropped into the vitreous. Central zone epithelium. As we all know, there are three zones in the there are three zones. There is a central zone of epithelium, there is an intermediate zone, and there is a germinative zone or peripheral zone. It includes equatorial and pre-equatorial. Three zones of epithelium are there. Central zone is central zone is not that active. Basically, there is no mitosis. This is a mitotic region, that is your peripheral or germinative zone is a mitotic. Intermediate is less mitotic. Central zone epithelium is nothing but polygonal in shape, flat section. There are cytoskeletal proteins present like actin, intermediate filaments. Then these crystalline proteins, you have to remember, alpha crystalline, which is present in the epithelium, which is present in almost all epithelium. Amidosmosomes attached to the basal aspects, and there is no mitosis. This is what you have to remember. There is no mitosis in the central epithelium. In the internal lip, the mitosis is occasional. This is the important zone. Germinative zone, or the most peripheral zone, is a major site of cell division. Just pre-equatorial and pre-equatorial. Site was similar to that. So these new cells form here, migrate posteriorly to take part in the lens fiber formation. This is what you should remember. This is the slide on how lens fibers initially formed. Initially, there will be an optic vesicle, and optic vesicle upon which there will be a surface epithelium, surface ectoderm. Lens placoid is nothing but there is a thickening in the surface ectoderm. There is a thickening and differentiation of some cells on top of the optic vesicle. There is a thickening and it forms lens placoid. This, when the optic vesicle forms a cup, optic cup, it forms an optic cup. Now at this stage, this will invaginate this lens placoid, and it will pinch off from the rest of the surface ectoderm. You can see clearly there is two types of cells. There is the anterior, which is colored blue, and the posterior, which is green, to differentiate. Initially, the blue, the green colored posterior lens fibers will elongate to fill in the cavity to form the first fiber, primordial fibers. This is the embryonic nucleus. Further, prepectoral fibers will elongate like this, will detach this initial fibers from their attachment and form the subsequent fibers. Coming to a little bit of ciliary zonules, initially there is an internal limiting membrane which is present in the continuation from the internal limiting membrane over the ciliary body, that is the pars plana and pars orbicularis, which gets thickened. That is the initial ciliary zonules. From then onwards, the ciliary zonules are secreted by the non-pigmentary epithelium cells of the ciliary body. So basically, the parts of ciliary zonules is, I am talking about the main zonules. There are some other zonules also. Main zonules are pars orbicularis, which is lining the pars plana. Then there is a zonular plexus lining the pars plicata of the ciliary body. Then there is the zonular fork, which has got a posterior limb, anterior zonular limb, and the equatorial limb. As the name goes, it is attached in the respective parts of the lens. Then, other than this, you also have to remember there are other zonules. For example, if this is the lens and this is the vitreous, and you all know this is the Burger space, this is one more, it's also called as one more zonule. As you all know, the name of this is Wieger's ligament. This is also considered as a zonule. And we have a ciliary body here. Ciliary body from the main zonules are coming. Then one zonule come also all the way from here to here. This is called as hyoid zonule. And the space between this triangular space between the hyoid zonule and the main zonule is called as Pettit's canal. This I am telling just because in case in future if they ask in your entrance exam, only that is the reason. Otherwise you don't have to remember all those things. Just in case if they ask in here, this space is known as Pettit's canal. Lot of name to remember here, just in case if they ask. Other than that, there are other zonules also, which is of not that. There is a circumferential girdle forming. That is not that important now. Coming to the histology of lens, just a picture on histology. You can appreciate a capsule here. Then these are the nucleated epithelial cells, anterior epithelial cells, and these are the lens fibers containing the main bulk of the lens. And what the causes for avascularity of the lens will be? Causes for the avascular epithelium being thin, regular arrangement of lens fibers, cellular organelles being very little, extracellulars being very little, and lens protein itself is an orderly arrangement, relative dehydration, semi-permeable character of the lens capsule, avascularity, and antioxidants.